differential forms. And at the very end of the previous part, I said about the exterior product of two differential forms. Their degree can be, it can be any degree, can be some p and q. It doesn't matter, and it's defined if we write them. If we look at the components. Less correcting them here than here, so this is J1 J. Then we, of course, we multiply term by term, and then we order properly the differentials, and we may have a minus or plus sign because of some change of this ordering. Of course, if there is if the sum of the, well, of course the result will be a differential form of degree p plus q. Only we have to notice that if this is higher than the this degree is higher than the dimension of the space all this lives in, then it will be zero, because if there are more, if we multiply more than n is the dimension of the whole space, if we multiply here more than n differentials, then we of course end up with zero. So this is the limitation. So this is what I wanted to mention. And what we were talking about before, there was also of course the action of differential one forms on vectors. Remember that this was just such a sum of the products of the corresponding components, and we showed that this because of the transformation rules for one forms and vectors, this is always the result is always the same independent of the coordinate system. But what is also possible, we can say that not a one form but a k form can act in a similar way but on a collection of k vectors. And of course it doesn't have to be just a vector, it can be a vector field that is some sort of a function that that assigns a vector to every point in space. So of course applies to vector fields, because these components can be functions and these just as well. But differential k form can act on a collection of k vectors, because it has essentially it has like k slots for vectors. And what we can do, we can define such it's called an interior product, when we we just, when we have this differential k form that can act on k vectors, but we plug in just one vector, and then we obtain something that has still room for k minus one vectors, and we obtain a different differential form that is, we call it alpha, that is a k minus one degree differential form. So this is what we can do, and everything, all these products, of course, are multilinear with respect to all the vectors that stand here, and the differential form that is in the first place. And one more thing that we have noticed is that the dimension of the space of differential k forms in living in n-dimensional space is given by the Newton symbol. As we said, it stems from the fact that when we take from the fact that if we have such a product of differentials, only the choice of the indices matters, because the different orderings of the same indices give just potentially a different sign, a minus sign or not, if the permutation is symmetric. The point is that different orderings of the same collection of indices is redundant. So this reduces the dimensionality of such a space to this number. And what we know from how it is defined, it's the fact that it's equal to this, and have two linear spaces that have the same dimensionality are, as we know, isomorphic. So there should be some isomorphism, some correspondence between the space of differential k forms in n-dimensional space and n minus k forms. And there is such an isomorphism, and it's defined by the here are some remarks, and now we start. This is the Hodge star operator, and very generally we can define it as, if alpha is a k form, both alpha and beta are k forms in an n-dimensional space, then the star acting on this k form beta, it of course should produce, this is an n minus k form, and it is defined as the interior product of these forms we started with, times the volume form that is in a rectangular coordinate system, is just the, when we multiply all of the differentials from 1 up to n. And oh, I didn't define the interior product of two forms of degree k. Well, for one forms, it is pretty straightforward. It would be for one forms. This is defined forms and we take the metric tensor S with by analogy with the dot product, the scalar product for vectors, that there is, we know that there is a duality of one forms and vectors, so we can see it as somehow natural. It should be like this, and generalizing this on higher order on higher order differential forms is done it's done essentially with this kind of action of k forms on k vectors. So
but you don't really need the metric to define the star operation. Do you need the metric?
I thought that this is... I thought that the scalar product that we can have, that it's not unique. That it requires the scalar product. It's
not unique. No, it requires epsilon to put it in. You don't need the metric structure. I think the whole idea of forms is that it avoids the notion of metricity in order to define all these concepts.
Well,
you see, because you don't need to raise the indices, because forms, by definition, have the index down and vectors have the index up. Therefore, metric tensor is redundant here in this construction.
In the construction of, yes, but in...
And when you take the simplest case of duality, then you also see that epsilon is needed, which is the star in formal notation, and you don't need the metric structure.
Okay, so in this construction, we just use the vector, the k vector, the collection of k vectors that is. That is dual to this element, and then we, without needing the metric tensor. Okay, I agree that this is the most. I've read that the hot star is something. Of course, there is a way of defining it without this, but it's that it's somehow not.
You see, this will be relevant for Maxwell equations, which I think you will discuss.
Yes.
Then you will see that metric is not needed to write down the Maxwell
equation. The definition contains the scalar product.
No.
Now the star is defined. The star beta is the form.
Yes, and I question this necessity to bring in the scalar product. Because
but if star in any case it must be a number times the maximum possible form.
But
the definition is that this is a form which fills up whatever is left.
Yeah, that is complementary
the
vector,
right?
To the that fills
that
up the volume form. Yes. And for well, just to see
and sure enough, it's epsilon I j k.
The simplest
case.
Simplest, maybe not really trivial example would be in just in R3.
Or epsilon alpha beta gamma delta.
This would be just the volume form. For one forms, it would be just the star. Because it's the simplest way to see it, just to see on the elements of the basis. So let's take a look. That is very, very straightforward. But, and of course, if we exchange cyclically here y and z, then of course here would be z and x and y. And the same, the opposite way. This is the x and cyclically for the ones that are left. times here there may be a minus sign can pop out. When it's applied to a K form, this is the same omega K times the degree of the form times the such an expression that depends on the dimensionality of the form and the degree of the form and the dimensionality of the space. And we can notice that if the dimensionality of the space is odd, then this will be always then this will be always even. So in a space of odd dimensionality, then this will be just star squared applied twice if we just identity, but sometimes minus sign might pop out. Okay, so this is what we will be going to use, and now I will move on to something maybe even more familiar than, well, this was maybe not familiar to, but now I will move to something quite familiar, that is the action of the D operator. We remember we introduced it the week before, but the action of this operator in three-dimensional real space, then it looks like this. I use are not completely random, we will see it in a short while. And if we act with the D operator, what do we get? The first component of the form X more multiplied by dy, what will it be? It will be this derivative with respect to x of this with a plus sign, because the dx ends up here in the front, minus the derivative of ax with respect to y, but with the minus sign, because here we end up with dy times dx, and we have to switch it to get the proper, proper ordering here. And, well, maybe to save time, oh, okay, I can, I suppose I can write it. Dx, dy, dz, plus dz, dx. Here we have at something times just the volume form, because here only the dx is missing, here only dy is missing, and here only dz is missing. So this is the only possible thing that we can have here. Any other multiplication would give zero. And as I said, here the x is missing. So here we get the derivative of the x component with respect to x, y with respect to y, and the z with respect to z. And this, if we think of these as components of a, again, as components of a vector, dx, dy, dz. We of course can do it because it is a two-form through the hot star. It is equivalent. It is somehow equivalent to a one form with these components, and the one form is a vector, so we can think, there's no problem, we can think of a vector like this, and here we notice that this is the divergence. So, we have this. Action of the operator of 0, 1, and 2 forms on in R3. If okay, so there's this, we can somehow summarize it by D acting on Z forms. So one form with components that look like the gradient, the curl, again, D acting on one form gives a two form with components that look like the curl, and divergence, again, D acts from two forms and gives a free form, which is a volume form times the divergence. Okay, how we can use it? Well, there are some identities that contain the gradient, the curl, and the divergence that up till now, just up till now, were very difficult for me to remember, but from now on they become easy because we can notice that, for example, the curl of a gradient of a function, if we use simply this this operator, we notice that this is just d squared, and as we know, the operator applied twice gives zero. Applied on a function in this case. And also there is another identity that is divergence of a curl. It is also zero, but in this language it is again very easy because it's again the D operator applied twice, so it is obvious that it is zero. Okay, and what else we can express with this? Well, we have the Laplacian operator, and in the ordinary vector calculus, I'm not referring to differential forms, applied to a function, it can be expressed as the divergence of a gradient. And applied to a vector quantity, it is expressed as a gradient of the can we express this Laplacian somehow nicely in the language of the operator and probably the hot star? Yes, we can. And now I want to show this. Okay. How shall we approach this? Okay, so let's look first at the curl applied twice, or maybe, no, maybe the gradient of divergence. Gradient of divergence. I use these names so that we maybe know better what's going on. And how would we apply this? So the gradient of divergence of a vector quantity. So a vector quantity is equivalent to a one form. We can say that, yes, a like this, a shorthand. But how would we apply this? First, the divergence, we said that this is the D operator applied to a two form. So we have to go first from a one form to a two form, and to do this we use the Hodge star. Then we apply the D operator, and this is the divergence. This stands for the divergence, okay? And then we have a free form. From this, because in the end we want to apply the gradient, and the gradient is the operator applied to a function that is a zero form. So again, we have to go back from free forms to functions, that is to zero forms. And in the end, we apply the D operator again to get, again, a one form. So this can be expressed as, well, here I was going from left to right, but it acts, we start acting here and end here. So this is D star is, okay, it's equivalent to the gradient of a divergence. And now the other term, that is the curl applied twice. How we do this? We start with the one form. Here is no problem. We just apply the D operator to the one form again and get a two form, and this gives us curl. But to apply the curl once again, we must go back to a one form. We do this with the hot star, and then we act with the D operator once again. And this stands for the second curl. We get a two form. And to go back to the one form again, we act with, once again, with the Hodge star. So, again, here we write from left to right, but we have to write the opposite. D star. So, in three dimensions, it seems that we can express the Laplacian as D star star minus star D star D. Okay, and is it, does it contain also this case? Here it turns out that it does, because the divergence the divergence of a gradient, that would be when we act on a function, that would be okay, we start with a function, we apply the D operator, one form, and this is the gradient. This is okay. Then later on we want to apply the divergence, so we have to go from one form to two forms, so we take the star, and we get a two form, then we apply again the D operator, and this stands for the divergence. This takes us to three forms, and we want to end up with a function again, so we apply, and we apply the hot star again to come back to a zero form. So we see that in this case it is...
The comment was that it was good that Max already know it.
Star, D, star. So here we have... We have this only with a plus sign, and here we have a minus sign. And it turns out that we can... that the sign that is here depends on the degree of the form that it is acting on. Because here it starts with a zero form, and okay, we can, how do we generalize? We can take this star. Call it, somewhere I heard the name covariant derivative, but it's covariant derivative, it associates something with else, but let's just give it such a symbol, and the action of it, well, here we requires a minus sign optionally times the degree of the when it acts on some differential form. Here we take the degree of the form times one, so degree of the form plus one. So if it acts on a form that has odd degree, then there will be no minus sign. If it acts on a form that has even degree, then there will be a minus sign. And then we see that if we say that the Laplacian is here we have this and d times d tilde plus d tilde times d, then we see that this contains both cases I presented for functions and vectors in three dimensions, and it turns out that this is a good generalization of a Laplacian to any dimensions. Any dimension the differential form lives in, and any dimension of any degree of a differential form. We can notice here that this is, what does it do? It acting on any dimensional, any degree in the K form, it here with the star it goes from K to N minus K, then with D it goes from N to N minus K plus 1, and then again with, okay, here was a star, here is D, here is again the star, it goes to k minus 1. So it acts somehow in the opposite direction. Okay, having this, we can, this is probably the end of this chapter. Now I want to come back to the Stokes theorem. This is also out of time. Oh, I'm running out of time, but I think I will cover this quickly. What does it say? It says that that the integral of differential of a derivative of a doesn't say. It says that if we, the integral of a differential form over some boundary of some kind of manifold, it is equal to the derivative of this form integrated over the interior of this, the object on the manifold of which this is the boundary, so to say. And we can see what special cases does this cover. If we start with a very simple thing, that is, let's say that in the place of omega, we just take just a function, a zero form. Okay, so let's start from this right-hand side. And then we have differential of a zero form, and this is a one form, so we integrate it over some oriented curve. And this is something that is very well known, that is, the result of this is just the difference of the values of the function at the end. And this is of course contained in this, because the boundary of this curve is just the set of two points. And it's of course it sounds funny, but it's an oriented set of two points. That is, the order which one is first and which one is second is comes from the orientation of the curve, of the fact that we go in this direction, not the opposite. And the integration of a zero form is just evaluation of the function on the on this set of points. So this simple case is contained, as I remember you mentioned this in the end of my previous talk. And of course it contains also for higher dimensionalities, for higher order differential forms, it contains the Kelvin-Stokes theorem, the Gauss theorem, but maybe I will not. Okay, I can, of course. Okay, if we have a one form, that is integrated over a boundary of some surface, that is one dimensional boundary of some, of course, two dimensional surface, then this is equal to the integral of the differential of this integrated over the surface. And here we recognize that, as we seen just before, this is equivalent to a curl, and we know from more maybe traditional vector calculus, such a theorem, that the integral of a curl of a vector for the surface is equal to the integral of the vector itself around the boundary. So this is called the Kelvin-Stokes theorem, as I've read. And another special case that is also quite known is the Gauss theorem, that would apply to a two form. Then we would have if we integrate the derivative, the differential of the two form over a volume. This is, as we've seen, that is equivalent to the divergence. That this will be equal to the integral of the form itself over the boundary of this volume. And this, when we use the symbol of the divergence, this is also known as I said, this is the Gauss theorem. Okay, so this is how the known special cases are contained in this. And now there's not much time, but I think that just now we are ready to see to come back to the Maxwell equations. Okay, well, I will grab some board. And first, okay, we have the Maxwell equations in the form of differential equations first. Still using the language of vectors here, but soon it will change. No, I won't write the integral equations. I will show how do they arise from the, because this is all, of course this is equivalent, the differential and in integral form, but I will show how the integral equations, Maxwell equations, arise from these. Once we will identify, oh no, not better, it will be better to do. Surface is to this volume. Okay. Surface is equal to zero. Here, what was mentioned also in the lecture about electromagnetism, that E and H are different objects, geometrically are different than B and D, and here it is very visible, very clearly visible that B and D are always integrated over surfaces, while E and H are integrated over curves, all over one-dimensional manifolds, and this is a hint that we should identify, how we should identify these objects as differential forms. We notice that E and D and H are one forms, and B and D are two forms. This comes from over what are they integrated. The density of charge is a free form because we see we integrate it over a volume. And also here we see that the current density is also a two-fold. Okay, so this is the identification in the language of differential forms, and now we can see that the equations can obtain quite a nice form. Namely, if we apply a divergence to, if we apply this, we notice that the divergence is what arises when we apply the D operator to a two form. So we see that this equation, the first equation translates to this, the second equation translates like this, the third equation and the fourth. As we remember, the curl is arises when we apply the D operator to a one form. So again, here the D operator arises this, and again in the last one, it's just the same. And here we see, of course, that it is all compatible with the degrees of all of the forms are compatible with each other. We can also, using the Stokes theorem, we can recover the integral form of the equations. Namely, if we apply integration over over a volume to both sides here, we get, instead of this, we get the integration of over the boundary of this volume of the D form itself, and get the right hand side. The same here. If we apply integration over a volume of this and use the Stokes theorem, we obtain this. Here, if we, because on both sides of here we have a two form, so we have to, this is a two form and this is a two form, so we have to apply integration over a surface. But if we do this, then we, again, we recover what we had in the first place. Here, integrating on one form over the boundary of this surface, and again here. Was before, and the same here. If we apply the integration over a surface, we get on this side, we get the integration of the H one form over the boundary of the surface, and here here we have the integration of the two forms that we have on this side over the surface. So this is how the integral equations recover from are recovered from this. And what more we can express? I know I'm running out of time, but please give me, like, I don't know.
And now there is a problem, because these equations are not complete. You need the constitutive relations, and they cannot be expressed in the language of forms.
The obvious,
they require extra structure.
That the J is a two form and the rho is a three form. And if we
E and D are related, but one is one form and the other is two form. And
what,
you cannot
about
make
the
them.
The hot star.
Hot star would not help, because E is not. If you apply hot star to B, you don't get H, because B is in the same direction, including the rule of the right hand. Hot star.
Unless you're left hand side.
Hot star is not applicable in this case.
Okay.
B is not a hot star of H.
Okay, but what about, because what I found, and I will be glad to learn in the last seconds we have. What can we do with the expressions that were given? I wasn't critical enough towards them, but what I found was this. Here's the epsilon. I understand the not as a number, but as some tensorial form.
But this requires an extra structure. You need something else in addition to form.
Yeah, but I mean, that's even with the current. The current is two form. And the current is a charge times a velocity.
Yes.
And the charge is a three-form, and the velocity is a vector.
Vector. Right.
So
the same
if you put all these stars, you can somehow manage to do so, but it's get, at least to say, less transparent.
Less transparent.
And the normal electron.
Probably the...
And try to calculate the property of a transformer using this.
Probably the least transparent is the formulation that says that the expression of the Maxwell's equations in this form, J, where
what's mu?
F is mu zero in free space where.
No, what is F?
F, I was about to define.
F mu
is the A, where A is, well, it's a different.
It's a Silberstein vector.
It's because I didn't manage to introduce the potentials, the scalar and vector potential, but it is.
But Maxwell equations do not require.
They do not require. They
potentials in Maxwell theory
are not necessary, of course.
Irrelevant. Everything is gauge invariant explicitly.
This is the A one form, and from this we obtain
F mu nu.
F, yes, this is F mu nu only in a bit different language, and then we can express the this equation contains just this and this, and the second equation contains the other two. So it's
no, why mu not? It's not present in Maxwell theory.
It's,
there is no mu in Maxwell equations.
It's
is J the same as in Maxwell equations
J
that you have written here?
J is the indices below is minus c times in this four dimensional, because this is all these are all forms in the four dimensional Minkowski space, and then this will be
it's rho.
Yes, this is rho. Yes,
rho. It's not phi.
Of course not. It's rho. And here
it's the phi rho.
And here are the components of the current free components of the current.
Yes.
This is so. I've run out of time to show this in a more careful way, but this is probably the. I will end here. Maybe there could be something more added, but this is essentially what I wanted to present. So I